place where we can't find peace. There's no end to amazing grace. Take me in with your arms spread wide. Take me in like an orphan child. Never let go, never leave my side.
Message that is right there in just that presentation we just seen, and the storms that we find ourselves in. And this, thank God for the change of the seasons, the warmer weather. Just talking to Dad yesterday, he's talking about planting green beans and corn and everything else he's planting. But along with those changes of the seasons, we find the violent storms starting to move in. And just like this past week, Sister Karen was sharing with us. And then it was also on Thursday that the phones are going off, the sirens going off for tornadoes time and time again. And as I was trying to get my thoughts together for the message this week, I was originally looking towards the Great Commission of what we as a church have been tasked to do and commanded to do. And it's often talked about, it's mentioned four times in the New Testament. But that's not where God wanted me to come from this morning, because as I continue to pray, and then the storm moves in on Thursday, it kind of opened my eyes to where we need to go with the message this morning. And the calming of the storm, one of the greatest miracles there talked about in Jesus' ministry and what he had done for his disciples there. And, you know, I'm not a big fan of the getting on an airplane or getting on a ship, there's really, I have no control once I get on there, that vessel. I'm out of control. It's all up to God, first and foremost. And of course, the pilot or whoever's guiding that aircraft or the... And you're probably thinking, as much as you fly, you don't like getting on a plane? Well, trust me, it's better than driving for 17 hours. Probably a little safer also. But if you want to hear some people praying out loud and crying the name of Jesus, put them on a plane 30,000 feet in the air and fly over the state of Texas. And the whole state of Texas is under severe thunderstorms and tornadoes all over the place across the state. And Texas is a pretty big state, by the way. We should know that because we're in Texas County, the biggest county in Missouri. So flying over the state of Texas, 30,000 feet, and the plane's shifting and rocking and violently rolling. It feels like it's just going to fall out of the sky. And luggage compartments flying open, oxygen masks are dropping down. There's one little girl sitting right over there, just asleep, right through it all. Everyone's kind of looking at her like, what's going on? She's just content. While everyone else is shouting the name of Jesus and praying out loud. And that little girl's name was Courtney, by the way. And her brothers still remind her of that she missed the storm. Because she was asleep, probably counting sheep or whatever it was she was doing. But the rest of us on that aircraft, we were pretty shook up. And sometimes we find ourselves in life situations that, why does it take a storm sometimes for us to call on the name of Jesus? And really looking back at it, and Christ puts it pretty clear, there's one thing usually missing, and that's humility, being humble, humbling ourselves as a child is. He says in Matthew 18:3, "Verily I say unto you, except ye be converted and become as little children, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven." And we had our men's a Bible study this past Wednesday. Raleigh, he summed it up pretty nicely as well. And when he said, you know, there's going to be a lot of people that miss out on heaven because of pride, because they won't humble themselves to call on the name of Jesus. And again, this miracle that we're going to look at this morning and talk about is the calming of the storms, coming from Matthew chapter 8, verses 23 through 27. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn there. And it's also mentioned in all three of the Gospels, three of the Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. It's in Mark chapter 4 and Luke chapter 8 also. And you can compare them later at your own time. And picking up in verse 23 here, it says, And when he entered into his ship, his disciples followed him. And behold, there arose a great tempest in the sea, and so much that the ship was covered with waves, but he was asleep. And his disciples came to him and awoke him, saying, Lord, save us, we perish. And he saith unto them, Why are ye fearful, O ye of little faith? Then he arose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. But the men marveled, saying, What manner of man is this, that even the winds and the sea obey him? What a blessing right there, and an example we can see and study and learn from, and we can see how it still relates to us even in today, in our life, as we decide to follow him just as his disciples did. But if we look back there, back in verses 19, he had just finished the Sermon on the Mount, and then we have some that are trying to step up to decide to follow him. They're feeling joyful, motivated in their heart to follow Jesus. But what does he say when he says, I will follow you anywhere, wherever you go? And then the Lord takes a moment to say, in a paraphrase here, really, well, the foxes don't even have any holes, or the foxes have holes and the birds have nests, but the Son of Man doesn't even have anywhere to lay his head. And taking that moment to realize that, obviously, we're like, whoa. You know, if I'm going to be following him, that means I'm going to be experiencing some hardships. I may experience, it's not going to be a glorious road that I was thinking. And then also the next one that was saying, well, let me first go and bury my father. Well, maybe in this young man's situation, maybe his father wasn't really dead yet, but he was saying, let me go back home until a time that's more convenient. Once my father passes on and I have nothing else to keep me at home, then it's more convenient for me, then I will decide to follow you. And how often do we find ourselves trying to put things off till it's convenient for us? And we see some that claim they are following, that claim to profess that we are Christian. But be careful, because we see how so many may claim that title, but even deny the very deity, the Trinity, the miracles, deny the miracles. Taking it all, there's really literally no way that could happen. They're basically, but yet they want to sit there and profess and claim that they are followers, they're Christian. Aren't we being judgmental this morning, preacher? Well, it also says, I mean, if we look over in Luke chapter 6 here, verses 43, for our good tree bringeth not forth corrupt fruit, neither doeth corrupt tree bringeth forth good fruit, for every tree is known by his own fruit. For the thorns of man do not gather figs, nor of a bramble bush gather they grapes. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is good, and an evil man out of evil treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is evil. So bottom line is, what we're seeing Jesus say is, the tree is known by its fruit. My disciples will be known by the fruit that they bear. Which kind of lines up along with that other sermon that I was talking about, the Great Commission, that we have as a responsibility, a command for the church, us individually as disciples, Christians. Instead of waiting on that convenient time, when it's convenient for us, realizing that right now is a good time to be about my Father's business, as Jesus so well put it. But then, you know, as a newly convert, we find ourselves really joyful, and sometimes we think maybe that road or that path is going to be full of an easy life. But it's really not the case, because we see how life's paths are full of hills that go up and down and the storms that come along. And sometimes you'll realize when I make that profession of faith and I sing that song, I have decided to follow Jesus, that it really gets a little rougher sometimes. We find ourselves under more persecution. More things coming up against us, more violently, more destructive, more often. And we see, looking at his true disciples here that followed him up on that ship, what happened. You know, thank God for technology that we have nowadays. Being able to look up the Weather Channel and say, well, you know, it's going to be sunny skies for the next 7 days and 80 degrees. We're going to go out there and we'll go ahead and put the green beans in the ground and the corn and get everything ready. But sometimes we don't have that insight to know, well, what's going on in the next 2 weeks. Because a lot of times, 10-day forecast is 10 days. But on the 14th day, after we've already planted the green beans and the bud rains and they've already sprouted and starting to come up, then we get the frost warning, and then next thing you know, we're back into the turmoil of wintry weather mix, and oh my goodness, when does it end? Maybe I should have waited till May. Have a late garden. But we sometimes get warnings with the storms, like when we were living over in Okinawa there, and for many years, we'd have typhoons, and it seems like you all were lucky this past year with the schools and the, you know, snow days, and you missed a lot of school and work.
Amen.
Well, it wasn't the case with us in Okinawa. We missed every weekend because there was a typhoon coming. Or a typhoon means hurricane, basically, and it shuts everything down, and you're strapped inside, and you can't go anywhere. However, my wife does attest that I cooked the best London broil during one of those typhoons. Well, I don't want to have to cook that London broil again in the typhoon, so I guess you'll never get another good London broil again. But those storms, we can kind of plan for sometimes in our life. But sometimes a storm comes in, and even a tornado nowadays, we can kind of gauge, hey, we got an alert on our phone technology, alert, hey, we got a tornado watch in effect or a tornado warning in effect for the next 8 hours. And then next thing you know, when it really gets time to grip and grin and reach down and hold on, we still get that warning. But ultimately in life's storms, sometimes we don't get any warning. It blindsides us and hits us when we least expect it. Maybe we're getting ready for that trip. We got to go up the road, and when we're planning that trip, how many of us just jump in the car and go on a road trip and don't do any planning whatsoever? I mean, I know we've done some journeys across the country on the bikes or whatever. Some of us been, you know, whatever type of mode of transportation, we got to plan for all that into effect, whether we're going to drive to the airport, park the car, what we're going to do with the car while it's gone, somebody going to take care of it, we're getting on a plane, or we're just going to drive the whole way, or we're going to take the car to the plane to the boat, and boat to another plane, whatever the case is. We got to plan for that. Got to plan for how much luggage we got to take. How long we're going to be gone. Sometimes you're going to be gone longer than you expected. Sometimes it's a little shorter trip than what you had expected. But no matter what, we still try to do a little bit of planning, and we try to plan the route that we're going to take along with the mode of transportation. And I know, again, technology sometimes is our worst enemy because we kind of get complacent. We think, well, I don't have to do as much planning. I can just get in the car, punch it into my phone, GPS, and take off. And follow the GPS, and then I punch in Starbucks, and then I end up in somebody's subdivision. Be careful what you follow. Because we see how we sometimes put too much confidence in man. Too much confidence in the technology that's here around us, what we can really see and touch, instead of what we can't see, but we have to have faith in. More confidence sometimes goes into the literal things in our life, instead of the magnificent. And no matter what, you know, you can plan, have the picture-perfect plan, and I've always been one of the students that's always heard, well, your plan always goes out the window on first contact. As soon as you pull out of the driveway, what we call crossing the line of departure, and we're on the move, sometimes everything changes right then. But again, planning is that preparation that is necessary in many cases. Learning that things look different when we're on the ground than what it looked like in the Atlas, than what it looked like on Google Maps, even though when we put it on whatever satellite mode, we can actually zoom in and look at the address numbers on the mailbox. But when we stand outside on the real ground and look at the mailbox, it looks totally different than it does from the bird's eye view, from Google Maps. And maybe by the time that Google Map picture was taken a year ago, 2 years ago or whatever, and by the time we get there, we realize now that mailbox is not even there anymore. Now there's an obstacle in our way. How do we get around it? Do we go through it? Whereas putting our trust and confidence in our God, our Lord Jesus Christ, through the path, through the planning, through the entire trip, and we're still going to sometimes face a storm. Even though everything, all the conditions are set and right, sometimes we're still going to face that storm, no matter what. And we see how the disciples, when they're following him and they're on that the ship, and Jesus is there asleep, sound asleep, and they think they're going to die. They're in extreme situation, extreme circumstances right now. They think they're about to perish. And that's when they're calling on the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, save us. We're going to die. In this case, he answers their prayers. Amen to that. And we see many times where we're unsure or what we're even praying about sometimes. And are we even praying the right prayer? Are we praying for God's will to be done in our life? And we see what his response was when he says, "Oh, ye of little faith, are you trusting not in me?" is basically what he's saying. And then what does he do? He rebukes the storm. And how wonderful, how peaceful it is after you get the all clear siren. The storm's moved on. And sometimes these storms might only last a few minutes. Literally here, the storms. They may last a few minutes, a couple hours. Sometimes they might last, if that typhoon's hovering over your head, it might be there for a couple days. But in life's journey, sometimes those storms last for years. What is our level of endurance and our commitment to stay the fight, stay the true to our word and to our commitment, our level of commitment to our Savior Jesus Christ? We see how they boasted so many that "I'll follow you to the ends of the earth," until he says, "What the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." And Peter says, "I'll lay down my life for you." And it wasn't shortly thereafter where he denied him three times, as we can see in Scripture. And we've also just recently finished up on Wednesday night there in the book of John. But in these answered prayers, we can see and look back and wonder, why did God not answer our prayers? Or maybe he did answer your prayer. Did you turn around and give that praise report when that prayer was answered? We even heard it and seen it on Facebook where someone would throw out a prayer request, pray for whatever, I'm going to the doctor or whatever the case is. And then next thing you know, "Oh, you don't have to pray now because everything came back fine." And well, was the prayer not answered already? Amen. But we kind of shifted it off. We wrote it off as, "Well, but that was just life, you know, that wasn't really God." Did we really do that? Did we just really fail to seize that opportunity to tell everyone else about how we were blessed through those prayers being answered? Failing to praise is what we so often find ourselves doing. We fail to give praise and that opportunity to testify and give everyone else insight of what's going on in our life and how we were blessed, how the Lord blessed us and took care of us, just as he did with the disciples, rebuking the storm. And they marveled at how wonderful. Who is this that can even control the waves, the sea, the storm? What a miracle. Obviously, right there in front of them. I mean, a visual witness. But we write that off as, "Well, you know, that was a good doctor's visit. You know, I don't have, you know, it turned up, the test results were negative, so I'm good. I'm going back to doing what I was doing." That was just chance. It was life. So, it's really not chaotic right now, so I can go back to living the way I was, and now I don't have to call on Jesus again until the next storm rolls in. And be careful how dangerous we find ourselves getting into that habit of complacency. And then we can hear the critics ridicule and rebuke and say harsh things about our God, just even as we those that went and seen the movie a few weeks ago. Why does God let bad things happen? Well, sometimes those answers are not really that clear. But I can tell you this, I learn from pain. That's me. And being my past, I've actually been on both sides of the street of going through what you would call basic training and also the one that was giving the basic training. And the ones, it's better to be on the giving end than on the receiving end. Giving the pain out. I remember as a young child, mess up in school. Okay, look here, Johnny. Get out here and hold the books out in your hands in front of the class. You want to act like a little knucklehead, then well, you're going to learn from some pain. Stack some books up on your arms and hold them out. Maybe that doesn't happen anymore. But this little book will get heavy, believe it or not. And it's painful holding that book out for quite some time. And then all the rest of your classmates poking at you. Holding your hand out and getting smacked by the ruler. A little bit of pain. I know we're not there anymore. But when you'd mess up, you would get disciplined is what I'm getting at. Maybe that's a form of discipline that we're facing in life when we have to fight the storm and go through the storm. But how we deal with the storm is another whole other situation. How we deal with it, and do we take it and become better and write things off and lose our faith altogether? Sometimes in the storm, we as the good neighbor, we have to leave that basement door unlocked. We got to leave the door open for the storm in other people's lives. And be there ready to reach out for the being that good neighbor. To invite, have that the open door policy where it's always welcoming, ready to receive, and be that blessing and use that opportunity to exalt the name of Jesus. So, learning through pain or sometimes just being told no. How many has been told no before? Mom, can I get $20?
No.
Mom, I really need $20. I need $20. I have this amount, but the watch costs $20 more, so I need $20. Please, Mom, I really need this $20. No. But Mom. But see, we don't like to hear no, so we keep what? Nagging and asking. But we realize sometimes we really just don't need the $20, and we definitely don't need the watch. But it may not take a short amount of time to realize that. It may take a long time to realize that. It might take a year or two or three or five, whatever, to realize that we really didn't need what we were just praying for. That's sometimes just the hard facts, that we were not praying for the Father's will to be done in our lives and used. Maybe we're getting a little selfish there for a moment and greedy or whatever the case is, and need to take that time out and reflect on what it is we're really praying for. May God's wonderful works be used through my life. And as we can look on to the Lord's Prayer as an example, as a foundation for us to pray, as a sincere prayer, that the Father's will be done. You know, sometimes we pray and we really just don't have the faith that that it's going to be answered, whether it's going to be yes or no, we think automatically it's going to be no. We don't like the answer no, but we know it's going to be no anyway. So then we kind of pray out of routine. There's a young child laying on the deathbed, been through time and time again, months of treatment for leukemia, and is in the final stages. And as he's lying on the deathbed, of course, he's from a Christian home, and he's been raised up in church. He believes, and then the church, the men of the church, the elders, the deacons, the leadership of the church come and lay hands on that young man, pray over that young man that he may be healed and live a long life. But it's not shortly after the group leaves that the young man looks to the mother that's right there by his side on his deathbed, and he says, "Mom, you know, God was going to heal me, but there was just one of them that didn't believe. Just didn't have the faith that God could do it." So he was already expecting a no before it all started. Or there's the man that's pretty much beaten cancer. He's made it through a hard journey, through all the chemo and the sicknesses and the ailments that go along with it, all the side effects. And now he's back on his normal life. He praises God and gives thanks to God, be the glory for all the wonderful works and the healing. But then a little more time goes on by. And then what happens? Kind of lose focus on God being first and foremost and the number one priority. And we find ourselves dipping back over into temptation, wandering and drifting back off on that wrong path. The wrong path. Maybe we got sidetracked, like we so often do, is in getting distracted down life's journey. And we already know the hills go up and down, but when we take the wrong road and the hills still go up and down, and then we're going to finally end up at the very bottom of the hill wondering how we got there by losing focus and taking our eyes off. Maybe we are already going through some of these storms, and we've been through some of these hardships along life's journey. Maybe we've kind of given up hope on ourselves, lost focus on who we should be putting our trust and confidence in. As they come with a song, maybe it's time for us to seize this opportunity if the Spirit's knocking on our hearts and minds, putting us under a point of conviction that now is the time to be about my Father's business, not a time of convenience when it's a good time for you, because we'll see that it's going to never be a good time for you, me. We have to realize it's on God's time, that now is the time to put our trust and turn everything over to God. Like I said, I don't like the planes and the trains and the automobiles by no means. And I definitely don't like it when I'm not in control. But who's in control of life? We could get hit with any ailment at any moment. And then be in the same situation, how we've seen and witnessed, and how we're going to deal with it now that it's upon us. So, as we close out today, let's reflect on our path down the highways, through the airways, the road ahead, and ensure that we have brought all of our burdens to put it on the altar and laid it on the feet for Jesus to take care of.